Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar, Approaches to Nucleic Acid Isolation, From Sample to NGS Analysis, presented by Dr. Stephanie Stepanoff, NGS Core Facility Manager, Private Molecular Diagnostic Lab, Cologne, Germany. I'm Christy Jewell of LabRoots and I'll be your moderator for today's event. Today's educational web seminar is presented by LabRoots and brought to you by GE Healthcare Life Sciences. To learn more about our sponsor, please visit gelifesciences.com. Now let's get started. I would like to remind everyone that this event is interactive, and we encourage you to participate by submitting as many questions as you want at any time you want during the presentation. To do so, simply type them into the Ask a Question box and click Send. We will answer as many questions as we have time for at the end of the presentation. If you have any trouble seeing or hearing the presentation, click on the Support tab found at the top right of the presentation window, or report your problem by clicking on the Ask a Question box. This presentation is educational and thus offers continuing education credits. Please click on the Continuing Education Credits tab located at the top right of the presentation window and follow the process to obtain your credits. I now present today's speaker, Dr. Stephanie Stepanoff. Dr. Stepanoff is an NGS Core Facility Manager in a private molecular diagnostic lab in Cologne, Germany. She's responsible for the establishment and validation of new NGS assays, as well as monitoring and optimization of current NGS workflows. For a complete biography on our speaker, please visit the Biography tab at the top of your screen. Dr. Stepanoff, you may now begin your presentation.
Oh, thank you very much for the nice introduction. The topic of my talk is Approaches to Nucleic Acid Isolation from Sample to NGS Analysis. Today, I will talk about how to check quality of liquid biopsy samples and the potential impact of the quality on data outcomes. We will review modifications to workflows, protocol steps, and NGS analysis. I would talk about benefits and drawbacks of different approaches to nucleic acid isolation with particular focus on column-based and magnetic bead-based isolation methods. Finally, we will review sequencing data comparing column-based and magnetic bead-based approaches. In molecular diagnostics, we analyze diagnostically and or therapeutically relevant markers in a genome or proteome of a patient. For this, a broad collection of techniques are available. The quantitative real-time PCR is the standard method in our lab, and we use it for the detection of fusion events, for SNP genotyping, the detection and verification of copy number variations, just to mention a few applications. PCR and subsequent Sanger sequencing is still the gold standard for the detection of germline variants. Fragment length analysis are used for the fetal aneuploidy testing as well as microsatellite instability, etc. Target-specific copy number variations and methylation aberrations could be checked through multiplex ligation-dependent probe amplification, MLPA. Array CGH is used for genome-wide screening for chromosomal aberrations. A very sensitive technique is the digital droplet PCR. That brings you down to 0.1% detection limit of a known mutation. Next-generation sequencing is a well-established method, and we could use this for screening and also targeted approaches with a high sensitivity. There are several NGS applications. I only mention some of the standards used in the clinical routine. The characterization of microbiomal communities becomes more and more standard analysis in the diagnostic lab. Mainly stool and vaginal swab samples are analyzed. A very special application is the polar body analysis, which is a single-cell analysis. This is the pre-implantation testing of in vitro fertilized oocyte to reduce abortion rates during the subsequent pregnancy. Furthermore, fetal aneuploidies could be analyzed through NGS analysis from the blood out of the mother. But the most commonly used application is the targeted resequencing of specific genetic regions to detect germline or somatic mutations. As you see, you have to handle a lot of different sample types in a diagnostic lab, and this is only one section and only some examples of applications. Besides the single-cell analysis, liquid biopsy samples used for the detection of somatic mutations and fetal aneuploidies are demanding, and I will focus on that sample type in this talk. What is liquid biopsy? It is the sampling of body fluids like blood, urine, saliva, and cerebrospinal fluid that to analyze specific biomarker. Circulating tumor cells or CTCs originate from a primary tumor and may, over the blood circulation, constitute seeds for development of additional tumors in distant organs. CTCs are very rare and difficult to enrich. CTCs are not routinely used in tumor diagnostics at the moment. The most commonly used biomarker is cell-free DNA in blood samples. Cell-free DNA is a generic term for cell-free circulating DNA in a liquid biopsy sample. Circulating tumor DNA, ctDNA, and cell-free fetal DNA are only a portion of cell-free DNA. Two processes are involved in the release of cell-free DNA into blood circulation. The first is the passive release of DNA through cell death, either by apoptosis or necrosis. During apoptosis, the nucleosome-associated DNA is cleaved by enzymes, resulting in a characteristic cell-free DNA length of around 166 base pairs. DNA released from phagocytosis of necrotic cells is larger, about 10,000 base pairs and higher. The second mechanism is by active secretion. Secretion of DNA takes place by the release of exosomes or other extracellular vesicles containing pieces of DNA around 150 and 200 base pairs. The amount of cell-free DNA is influenced by several factors like age, stress, or even inflammation. But also cancer cells and the developing fetus releases DNA into bloodstream, which is the cause that we could use liquid biopsy samples in a diagnostic routine. The first FDA-approved application of liquid biopsy was the screening for fetal aneuploidies in maternal blood, the so-called NIPT, non-invasive prenatal testing. This method has the advantage that the collection of blood of the pregnant woman is minimal invasive compared to the more sensitive tissue sampling via amniocentesis, which could lead to an induced abortion of the fetus. Routinely, NIPT is used to screen for aberrant chromosomes 13, 18, and 21, and if wanted, sex chromosomes. Also, the detection of whole genome aberrations are possible. The fetal cell-free DNA fraction correlates nicely with gestational age, and after the 10th or the 12th gestational week, the cell-free fetal DNA fraction is more than 4%, which is considered to represent a threshold for reliable testing. This makes it easy to standardize the workflow in the routine. Liquid biopsy analysis in cancer patients are much more difficult to standardize. The amount of released tumor DNA depends on the tumor entity, disease stage, or tumor burden, and also the microenvironment of the tumor. For example, the access to blood vessels, etc. As a consequence, the circulating tumor DNA could vary a lot between patients, even in the same disease stage. That makes it so difficult to standardize circulating tumor DNA analysis in a routine lab. But the advantages of liquid biopsy is the minimal invasive sampling, the accessibility, and the possibility to collect samples at short intervals. Furthermore, tissue biopsies often do not reflect the heterogeneity of a tumor. Liquid biopsy analysis in cancer patients could be used for cancer detection even at early stage and molecular profiling of the tumor. After surgery, the detection of residual disease could be done by sensitive approaches like qPCR, digital droplet PCR, or NGS. During treatment, the response could be monitored as well as the clonal evolution of recurrent tumor cells. To establish the cell-free DNA analysis in a routine diagnostic lab, the characteristics of cell-free DNA should be considered. Cell-free DNA shows low concentration in plasma as well as other body fluids. In healthy controls, cell-free DNA concentrations from 0.3 to 10 nanograms per milliliter plasma were described. In cancer patients, concentrations from 8 to 800 nanograms per milliliter plasma were found. Cell-free DNA has a short fragment length, which is directly depends on the origin of the DNA. As I mentioned before, cell-free DNA released from apoptotic cells show a mean fragment size of around 166 base pair 2 to enzymatic cleavage. Cell-free DNA from necrotic cells are often large, over 1,000 base pairs. Active release cell-free DNA shows a mean fragment length around 150 and 200 base pairs. Important is to know that cell-free fetal DNA is in the mean shorter than the cell-free maternal DNA, as you see in the picture. The same characteristic could be found in cancer patients, where melanoma cell-free DNA is enriched in the shorter fragments compared to healthy donor cell-free DNA. The establishment of cell-free DNA routine analysis includes some pre-analytical considerations. The choice of blood collection tube is very important. There are several blood collection tubes for the sampling of cell-free DNA on the market. These contain nucleic acid and cell-stabilizing additives that prevent the cell-free DNA and white blood cells from degradation. The usage of plasma versus serum needs to be considered. Total cell-free DNA levels are 1.6 to 11-fold higher in serum compared to plasma samples. It was also shown that the isolated cell-free DNA integrity is higher in serum compared to plasma, but the measured allele frequencies in serum were lower compared to plasma samples. Kloten et al. Compared serum versus plasma and also two different extraction methods, beads and membrane-based isolation kits. I come to that later in more detail, but you could see on this figure the measured allele frequency in serum are lower compared to plasma samples, at which the experimental detected frequency from the plasma samples reflect the expected allele frequencies. The release of cellular DNA seems to be taking place during the blood clotting process from lysing cells, and this explains the higher yield and integrity of circulating DNA obtained from serum. As a conclusion, serum is more unstable and difficult to control fluid due to the coagulation process, but may be used if plasma is not available. In addition to blood collection tubes and specimen type, the storage, which means temperature and duration, should be tested and established in the lab. The storage duration depends on the type of blood collection tube you use. When you analyze plasma samples, the centrifugation procedure has to be tested and validated with the local equipment. Parameters to test are speed, time, temperature, and number of spins. All parameters could have an influence on cfDNA DNA yield and quality and needs to be carefully considered in the clinical routine. One major factor that influences yield and quality of cell-free DNA is the choice of the extraction method. Two most commonly used methods are silica-based membrane, so-called column-based, and magnetic bead-based isolation methods. The already mentioned study from Kloten et al. Compared the membrane-based chiome-free circulating nucleic acid kit from QIAGEN with the bead-based Maxwell RSC cell-free DNA plasma kit from Promega. The figure shows a comparison of measured cell-free DNA quantities in nanogram per microliter isolated with membrane and bead-based isolation kits. Left, the quantities of the short fragments below 600 base pairs are shown. In the right, the measured quantities of the long fragments are compared. As you can see, membrane-based isolation promotes extraction of long cell-free DNA fragments compared to the bead-based isolation method. On the left figure, the percentage of fragments are compared between the both isolation methods with particular interest in short and long fragments. The magnetic bead-based isolation method recovered more efficiently shorter fragments of cell-free DNA. Besides the small differences in fragment length preference, differences in yield and quality of the extraction methods have to be tested and validated for the needs of subsequent analysis steps within the local setting. To establish a quality control for cell-free DNA samples, you have to consider the cell-free DNA characteristics, low concentration, and short fragments. For quantification of cell-free DNA, you could use fluorescence-based methods like Cupid or an equivalent technique. Please do not use absorption methods. They are not sensitive enough. This fluorescent dye intercalates in double-stranded DNA, and the procedure is cost-effective, rapid, and simple. To measure fragment length and a possible contamination with longer fragments of white blood cell DNA, the bioanalyzer or fragment analyzer from Agilent are a good choice. Both are very sensitive capillary gel electrophoresis. You need only small amounts of DNA. We use both methods to control the quality of cell-free DNA in our lab. Some labs use qPCR instead of qubit and bioanalyzer. This has the advantage of detection of portions of amplifier DNA in your sample. When you establish a multiplex qPCR amplifying different amplicon lengths, you could also get information about integrity of the sample. Besides that, a methylation-specific qPCR could quantify the cell-free fetal proportion in your sample. What kind of QC measurement you establish in your lab depends on your preferences and your lab equipment. Important is to not overmeasure the sample and save material. The cell-free DNA attributes also have an impact on downstream processes. The short fragment length limits the amplicon length if you use PCR for target enrichment and subsequent NGS analysis or even qPCR. The amplicon must be shorter than 150 base pairs, better is around 120 base pairs, or you perform whole genome sequencing that it is in an NIPT analysis. And as I mentioned before, mutated alleles from cancer origin are enriched in shorter fragments. A selection for short fragments could improve the outcome, either by experimental enrichment with a magnetic bead-based extraction method or by bioinformatical enrichment of short fragments. The low concentration is the most challenging parameter. With such limited material, you have not unlimited attempts to get to the result. The analysis strategy should be based on low amounts of input DNA. I prefer personally, PCR enrichments over hybridization methods because they are more specific and you only need low amounts of DNA. But it has been shown that also some hybridization strategies work on cell-free DNA. But to achieve a certain sensitivity, you need a certain amount of input DNA. 20 nanograms of DNA correspond to 6,600 around haploid genomes. If your clone has 1% allele frequency, you have to detect 66 alleles in your analysis. Also, the contamination with white blood cell DNA reduces the chance to get the mutated alleles. Using unique molecular barcodes, so-called UMIs, could increase the sensitivity by reducing background signals. Recently, we started the establishment of a cell-free DNA NGS analysis workflow in our lab, and I would like to show you the first results. We compared two extraction methods, the column-based isolation kit, QIAM circulating nucleic acid kit from QIAGEN, with the bead-based kit, Zera extractor cell-free DNA isolation kit from GE Healthcare. As a reference, we used the HD817 sample from Horizon Discovery. This is fragmented DNA in a synthetic plasma matrix. The reference contains four samples with spiked pathogenic mutations with 5%, 1%, 0.1%, and a wild type with 0%. The NGS library was performed with a custom multiplex PCR panel which uses the AmpliSeq HD technology from Thermo Fisher Scientific. That technology provides unique molecular indices. The mean amplicon size of our panel is around 114 base pairs. The eight libraries were then sequenced on ES5, the ion torrent technology, on a single chip. The procedure of the comparison is shown here. The 1 milliliter per sample was divided into two 0.5 milliliter plasma samples. The isolation was performed following the respective instruction of the kits, except the elution. This was modified to 30 microliters in low TE. Then quality control with qubit and bioanalyzer were performed. After normalization of the input DNA, library preparation including library quality control via qPCR was done, followed by subsequent sequencing on ES5. The preparation of the cell-free DNA was done manually, and the duration of the prep was equal between both kits. The first quality control step was the quantification of the isolated cell-free DNA. On that figure, you see the concentration in nanogram per microliter of the cell-free DNA isolated by bead-based method compared to the column-based method. As you can see, there's a five-fold higher differences between the two methods. The blue line indicated the expected concentration given by Horizon Discovery. This was calculated considering the elution volume of 13 microliters. The dotted line indicate the maximal concentration given by the amount of DNA used for the production of the reference plasma sample. The cell-free DNA isolated with the QIAGEN kit is above this maximum. Therefore, an overestimation is suspected. Then, the fragment length was checked by a bioanalyzer and the DNA high sensitivity assay. For this experiment, we verified the findings in the literature. Bead-based isolation recover more efficiently short fragments. Before library preparation, we normalized the DNA input to 20 nanograms. The library prep was done in parallel, and library QC was performed using the respective ion-torrent qPCR kit. The quantification revealed the differences between the two extraction methods. The QIAGEN cell-free DNA showed a 2 times lower final library concentration than the bead approach. Routinely, we normalize our NGS AmpliSeq HD libraries to 100 picomolar, what we could not do in this experiment. You have to keep that in mind when you look at the sequencing results. The total read counts reflect this pooling method. We have more reads for the bead-based sample compared to the membrane-based samples. But when you look at the percentage of Q20 bases and the mean read length, there's no difference between the samples isolated either by column-based or bead-based approaches. Furthermore, what is not shown here, the on-target reads and the uniformity of the coverage is very similar and showed no differences between the two setups. So we could say that the NGS data quality is comparable between beads and membrane-based isolation methods. The next and maybe the most important question is, are there differences in the sensitivity between both isolation methods? And is our NGS workflow sensitive enough to detect all mutant alleles? The used Horizon reference sample comprised 4 samples with spike pathogenic mutations in 5%, 1%, and 0.1% frequency, and a wild type. You could see the frequency of reads with the mutant allele and the total coverage at the position of the pathogenic mutation G to D at position 12 in key rays. We did not find the 0.1% mutation in the QIAGEN prepared samples. This may be due to the lower read coverage resulting from the lower total reads. The next mutation we look at is the amino acid change from E to K at position 545 in PIK3CA. Again, we have problems to detect the 0.1% mutation independent of the extraction method. Obviously, our tested workflow is not robust enough to detect 0.1% mutation frequencies. So we have to adapt the workflow to get a better sensitivity, and we will start to increase the DNA input in the library preparation. But to that point, we could say that both extraction methods could show an equal performance regarding the sensitivity. To summarize this talk, we could say that cell-free DNA is a challenging biomarker because of low concentration and short fragment length. A lot of variables could influence yield and quality of cell-free DNA. Therefore, it's important to carefully consider all variables during the establishment of a clinical routine. But we could see that magnetic beads recovers more efficiently short fragments compared to the membrane-based method. And both extraction methods showed comparable NGS data quality and sequencing results in our lab. In the end, I would like to thank my team for helping me with that establishment and GE Healthcare for the opportunity to test DeCrit before launch and also to present my data in this presentation. And you for your attention. I'm happy to answer your questions.
Thank you, Dr. Stepanoff, for that informative presentation. It is now time for our live Q&A portion of our webinar. Now to our audience, if you have not submitted your question yet, please do so now. Just click on that Ask a Question box located on the far left of your screen, and we will answer as many of your questions as we have time for. Okay, let's get started. Our first question is, let's start with this one. We already have some great questions coming in. Can I use any nucleic acid isolation kit for cfDNA extraction?
Look at my voice. It's got raspy from a lot of talking. Okay. While this may work, generic nucleic acid kits are not optimized for cell-free DNA extraction, so this is the sensitivity and the recovery will not be efficient enough, and I think the output would be poor.
Now, can I use any blood vacutainer for storing blood for cfDNA analysis?
No. Best practice would be to use any blood collection tube specific for cell-free DNA analysis. Because this is there are additives in it. They preserve the nucleic acid for degradation and also stabilize blood cells to minimize the release of genomic DNA. Okay.
Thank you. Now, how long do you store the blood in the plasma and under what conditions?
This really depends on the kind of blood collection tube you use. In our lab, we have experience with Streck cell-free DNA blood collection tubes, which you could store about 14 days from 6 to 37 degrees, and Biometrica blood collection tubes, which are stabilizing the cell-free DNA for up to 7 days. In routine, we centrifuge the blood as soon as possible, that means within 24 hours, and store the plasma then at minus 80 degrees.
Thank you. Why the 150 BP or lower?
For the design of the multiplex assay, the maximum of the cell-free DNA is at 166, so to say, base pairs. And the smaller one, like cell-free fetal DNA or the circulating tumor DNA is more smaller, so you have to have the chance that you get a PCR product from it. So I would recommend to use a multiplex PCR approach with 120 base pairs, but it works also with 150 or also 170 base pairs.
Thank you. Can you explain the difference in estimation of cfDNA concentration overestimation of QIAMP and absence of difference in sensitivity?
The overestimation coming from the QIAGEN kit, I would explain by the usage of carrier tRNA used in the QIAGEN workflow. This is a double-stranded RNA, and the dye of the qubit may intercalate to the double-stranded portions. So this is why it's maybe overestimated. And we are not finished with our establishing process or validation process. So I could not really say why there's no differences or there's no difference in sensitivity. I would say this is this 0.1% is very low concentration, and this is the advertised detection limit of that assay we used. And we used, therefore, 20 nanogram input, DNA input, which is around 6,600 haplogenome copies, and 0.1% means that you have to find and sequence 6 to 7 alleles. And I think we have to increase the DNA, and then we could say something about the sensitivity of that assay.
Thank you. We've got some great questions coming in. Let's go with this next question. What problem can we have if we choose more than 150 BP, for example, 200 or 300 BP?
When you choose larger or longer amplicons, you maybe get a bias in your output. So cell-free DNA is preferably shorter fragments. So I think you miss some, you miss the sequence in your analysis then. We've seen it. We've done multiplex fragment length analysis, and we missed the longer fragments in our outcome.
Thank you. Now, while using AmpliSeq for sequencing, do you think that the error rate would have improved by using a different sequencing platform, such as Illumina?
We know about the differences. We have both platforms in our lab. So the Ion-Torrent platforms has high reproducible error rates in homopolymer regions. And the Illumina error rates, they are more by accident. So with this reproducible error rates, we could analyze reference DNA, but we know that there are certain mutations at certain positions, and then we could normalize or train our bioinformatic pipeline. For the Illumina, this sequencing is better than compared to the Ion-Torrent analysis, but the not systematic errors are difficult to define as artifacts, because we are going down to a really low allele frequency, so 0.1% is really challenging. Use it, but there are also some techniques using human eyes with Illumina sequencing. So in our lab, we have both platforms for this. We use Ion-Torrent.
Excellent, thank you. What is the cause of the overestimation of cfDNA extracted with the QIAGEN kit?
Oh, as I mentioned some questions before, I think this is the usage of the carrier tRNA, but I'm not sure. I've asked the qubit support, and they couldn't answer me this question. So this is just I suspect the carrier RNA.
Thank you. Now we have an attendee asking, I missed how much cfDNA was present in the Horizon controls.
This is written in the Horizon Discovery information sheet. I'm not sure. I said maximum. I have to look it up. Sorry, or you will find it on the specification sheet for that HD817 sample.
Okay, thank you. Is extraction efficiency the same with various cfDNA stabilization tubes?
We tested only Streck and Biometrica blood collection tubes in our lab, and we find the same results. But this is one you have to test. This is one to be considered and to be tested in your lab settings.
Thank you. Now, we have so many great questions coming in, and I want to make sure we try to fit them all in, but if we are unable to answer some of these questions due to time constraints, I want to remind our audience that these questions will be answered via email to the contact information that you provided at the time of registration.
Yeah, sure.
So let's Keep going. Our next question, can you detect mutations that are localized near the end of a DNA fragment, especially the short ones, for example, less than 70 BP?
I'm not sure if I get the question. So if you have this PCR amplicon sequencing, it is the detection is not related or does not depend on the position in the amplicon, because it's not like in Sanger sequencing where you have get the signal over the noise. I'm not sure if that was answering the question, but this, we could all localize all mutations in the whole amplicon.
Okay, our next question. What are the risks of using more than 170 BP?
To miss the information.
Okay. Do you think enrichment of specific cfDNA fragments that contain mutations of interest would increase sensitivity of NGS?
Some papers show, some studies show that the enrichment of short cell-free DNA fragments could increase the sensitivity of NGS. So, as I mentioned, it could be done by the usage of maybe an extraction method, which efficiently recover more short fragments, or bioinformatical. I know for the NIPT workflow that this is done, though that they enrich the short fragments and increase their sensitivity.
Thank you. Now our next question. I already use a column-based kit in our lab. Why change to MAG bead-based kit for cfDNA isolation?
Oh, when it's working, you don't have to change. In our lab, we decided to change because of automation. We would like to have an automatable workflow in our lab. And also, the enrichment of shorter fragments could be an advantage. And we don't want to use this centrifuge or vacuum methods in our lab anymore. But the main reason is the automation.
Thank you. Is your method automatable?
Both kits I used in this comparison. The QIAGEN kit is somehow semi-automatable. So it's done with this vacuum container, and then it could be enriched or isolated using the QIAQ and the Serra extractor beads. This is fully automatable.
Thank you. Okay, let's see. We have so many great questions coming in. Let's go with this one. Do you think stabilization chemistry, such as cross-linking, use of formaldehyde, impact extraction efficiency or workflow?
Yeah, it's like FFPE. It's also formaldehyde cross-linking, and it's have a great influence on the subsequent NGS analysis. Sorry.
Thank you. Here's a great question. What kind of extraction method do you prefer?
Both kits have their benefits and drawbacks, and as I said, in our lab, we prefer an automated solution because we have a lot of or many liquid biopsy samples. But the point is, whatever extraction method you use, you have to carefully establish and validate the workflow under the conditions in your lab.
Thank you. Now we have time for a few more questions. Have you tested different analysis techniques on cfDNA extracted with the mentioned kits?
Yes, we have also tested digital droplet PCR and the NIPT workflow. And we found all aberrations and mutations with both methods, so the results are highly comparable.
Thank you. Let's go with this next question. I think we can fit in two more. How can isolated Ceph DNA be quantified?
Okay, I showed you that we could quantify it with a fluorometric method like Qubit, and then also look at the fragment length of the bioanalyzer or the fragment analyzer. Some labs have a qPCR established, but you can also quantify the cell-free DNA using digital droplet PCR or NGS by counting the alleles, tumor mutated alleles.
Thank you. And we have time for one last question. We'll wrap with this one. Does GE have other kits that I can use for my sequencing workflow?
Yes, I think so. GE is more and more becoming a solution provider for the NGS market, and they're planning to launch a series of kits to complement the NGS portfolio. And I know about the FFPE kit, which I'm also interested in. Also, they have PCR and qPCR solutions, and I think they also have a library prep, size selection, and cleanup kit. Yes, of course, they have some magnetic beads for library and cleanup, PCR cleanup.
Thank you. Now, I do want to thank you again, Dr. Stephanie Spana, for your time today and your important research. I'd also like to thank LabRoots and our sponsor, GE Healthcare Life Sciences, for underwriting today's educational webcast. Before we go, I want to thank the audience for joining us today and for their interesting questions. There were quite a few questions we were unable to answer. So those questions we were not able to answer and those that are submitted during the on-demand period will be addressed by Dr. Stepana via the email address you provided at the time of registration. Thanks for joining us, and we hope to see you again soon. Have a great day.